Welcome to Behind the Scenes with the New Jersey Motion Picture and TV Commission. This program is sponsored by the Holland Township Free Public Library, and we are delighted to welcome Joe Marra, production coordinator with the commission, as our featured guest tonight. Welcome, Joe.
Thank you so much. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you for having me. Thanks so much, Jan, for setting this up and organizing this event and inviting me to speak. Hopefully, I'll be sharing some information with you that you didn't know, and you'll have a better idea of just why New Jersey is so integral to the film industry and why we're so glad that it's come roaring back over the last couple of years. As Jan said, my name is Joe Marra. I'm the production coordinator for the New Jersey Motion Picture and Television Commission, State's Film Office. Our job is to promote New Jersey to the film industry for the economic and image benefits the state receives. We're going to talk a little more later about what that exactly means. I have to confess, I don't know much about Holland Township, except that you have a really cool windmill. I saw that on NJ.com's rundown of the most interesting part about every municipality in the state. So I got to check that out at some point. Certainly more interesting than the town I grew up in, Cranford, and the town I live in now, Clark, which was a bar and a diner, respectively, for the most interesting things about them. So just like in real estate, movies and TVs are all about location, location, location. And New Jersey truly has them all. Mountains, beaches, swamps, bustling cities, small towns, industrial complex, huge lakes, and little ghost towns, all within a couple of hours of each other. The only locations we don't have are deserts and jungles, but where there's a will, there's a way. In the remake of The Manchurian Candidate, they used the Eagles Lake sand mining facility down in Ocean County to play for Kuwait, and Across the Universe used the Meadowlands to play for Vietnam. Before we go any further, I want to show you a little video I put together highlighting some of the projects that have shot in New Jersey over the years.
Into you, baby, in electricity, can't compare to what I feel when I'm with you, oh baby, giving up my guts for you, now I'm seeing through you, give me a feeling,
may I ask if you are here in part of the
I know why I'm here.
Look at this place!
Things are pretty weird around.
I was wrong. I love the Jersey Shore.
Are you ready for the fun part?
Oh, yeah.
Even if I could, I wouldn't know you. I would stop the world for you. You know, I wanna let you know. I'll never let the ceiling go. This love has no ceiling. I cannot deny.
That wasn't bad. What else y'all got?
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
All I see is you, baby. But I waken in my dreams. I see your face so vividly. Don't know what I do. Ooh, baby.
So the conventional wisdom seems to be trying to get out of Camden. Why are you used to be?
Because the need is in Camden.
Y'all need to play like this.
All right, just a little something fun that I put together.
Did you? Oh, I'm sorry. I know we were going to wait till after, but did you say that the Vietnam scenes were shot at the Meadowlands?
That's correct. Yep.
Wow, amazing.
Isn't it pretty cool? Yeah.
Yes, it is.
Okay, so I'm sure you've all noticed there's been quite an uptick in film production in the state in the last couple of years. This year alone, we've had some major motion pictures filming all over. Oscar-nominated actress Naomi Watts stars in a remake of the Austrian horror film Goodnight Mommy, which shot in Bedminster back in May. The Big Bang Theory actress Maya Bialik wrote and directed a film called As Sick As They Made Us, which also stars Dustin Hoffman and Diana Agron, shot in Essex and Bergen counties back in the spring. Kevin Smith's latest, Clerks 3, filmed at the end of the summer in his usual spots, Middletown, Red Bank, and other spots in Monmouth County. This one was especially exciting for us because he hasn't shot a film in New Jersey since Clerks 2 back in 2005. Academy Award winner Sir Ben Kingsley stars in an E.T.-like movie called Jewels, which shot in Essex and Morris counties over the last 2 months. Gabrielle Union from the Bad Boys franchise shot a Netflix romantic movie called The Perfect Find in Newark at the beginning of the summer. James Gray, who made a couple movies with Joaquin Phoenix in New Jersey called The Yards and Two Lovers over the late 90s, early 2000s. He's back with a new movie with Hannibal Lecter himself, Sir Anthony Hopkins, alongside Oscar Isaac, Donald Sutherland, and Bill Burns, Anne Hathaway, which has been filming in Bergen and Hudson counties. The latest comedy from Judd Apatow Productions, which is responsible for several of my favorite comedies from the last decade, like The 40-Year-Old Virgin, is shooting his latest rom-com, but with a twist. This one centers on a gay couple played by Billy Eichner and Luke McFarlane. This is the first studio comedy to have a gay couple as its main characters. It's about time. For those of you that watch HBO Succession, cousin Greg, played by Nicholas Braun, is currently shooting a new movie called Cat Person at Fairleigh Dickinson University and other locations in Essex and Hudson counties. South Orange native Zach Braff is back 17 years after Garden State with a new film called Good Person, starring Florence Pugh and Morgan Freeman. It's currently shooting in Essex County. If you have the streaming service Peacock and check out their adaptation of the popular podcast Dr. Death, you'll see Christian Slater and Alec Baldwin at a medical review board hearing that's supposed to take place in Dallas, but that was in Patterson. Wu-Tang and American Saga, the Hulu show about the hugely influential early 90s hip hop group, just finished the second season. The group was formed in Staten Island, but season two was shot almost entirely in North Jersey. And I just found out recently that the group's leader, Bobby Diggs, also known as the RZA, lives in Millstone, and he advocated pretty fiercely for the second season to come to New Jersey from New York. Ben Stiller has a new show coming to Apple TV Plus called Severance. It shot at Bell Works in Homedale back in March, the former Bell Labs building that was abandoned for years and is now a spectacular sight to behold. I highly recommend you check it out next time you're in the area. USA Networks has a competition show from the creator of The Miracle Mop, Joy Mangano. Just started shooting at Newark Symphony Hall last month. It's called America's Big Deal, and it's described as Shark Tank meets QVC, where entrepreneurs pitch new products that viewers can buy live on air. We're particularly excited about this one as Newark Symphony Hall was especially hard hit by the pandemic, and this production has been an absolute lifeline for them. I'm sure you know that the CBS show The Equalizer, starring Newark native Queen Latifah, has been shooting all around North Jersey. But did you also know that the network's other procedural show, FBI Most Wanted, has been filming here as well? They're in season three right now, with NJ having a prominent role in each season. Not to be outshone in the police procedural game, NBC brought back Christopher Maloney as Detective Elliot Staler for Law & Order Organized Crime, which has shot two seasons here, also in North Jersey. You'll be hearing, I said a lot about North Jersey there, but our commission represents the entire state, and we love to show a lot of love to South Jersey every chance we get. McDreamy himself, Patrick Dempsey from Grey's Anatomy, shot a pilot for CBS called Ways and Means, which took place in Washington, D.C., and used the State House in Trenton to play for the Capitol building. We were worried the project was going to be a casualty of the pandemic, as it was supposed to shoot in spring 2020, but they ended up pushing the shoot to the beginning of this year. Unfortunately, the pilot wasn't picked up. Adam Sandler's latest comedy for Netflix, the LeBron James-produced Hustle, shot at the Atlantic City Airport just recently. And M. Night Shyamalan's Apple TV Plus horror show starring Rupert Grint, Ron Weasley, for my fellow Harry Potter fans, shot on the Ocean City Boardwalk back in March. So that's just 2021. We could be here for hours talking about all the major films and TV shows that have shot in NJ over the years. And we'll certainly talk about a lot more later, but I know we all have things to do after this, Netflix or Hulu to watch. So I'm gonna keep this more tightly focused on Hunterdon County before we take a deep dive into the history of the film industry as it relates to New Jersey. I did a little digging into our files, and there are close to 400 projects that have shot in Hunterdon. Among those are 57 feature films, the Academy Award-winning James L. Brooks film, As Good as It Gets, starring Neptune City's Jack Nicholson and Helen Hunt, shot in Glen Gardner back in 1996. I couldn't find out exactly where. I'd have to go dig into our archives in our building to find the paper files, so I'm going to have to look into that. Newark native Ray Liotta played a serial killer strolling through Clinton in the notorious flop Turbulence, also shot in 1996. Apparently, it caused a lot of problems in Clinton, but I think that they're pretty happy with filming now. In and Out with Kevin Kline, also shot in Clinton, 1996. So a lot of stuff shot in Clinton, just prepare you guys. One True Thing with another New Jersey native, Summit Born and Bernardville Raised, Meryl Streep, also shot Clinton, 1997. Anger Management with Adam Sandler and Jack Nicholson, shot in Alpha and West Amwell in 2002. I Am Legend, this is probably, I would say, one of the more famous ones, shot in Lambertville, Califon, and West Amwell. This was for the original theatrical ending of the film where, spoiler alert, but not really because the movie's over a decade old, Will Smith blows himself up so that Alice Braga can take the vampire cure to the human resistance, which was out in a fortress in the Hunterdon County woods. A recent film that took advantage of the state's new tax credit program, or newish tax credit program, which we'll talk more about later, shot in Lambertville just 2 years ago in 2019, pre-pandemic. Everything in this sentence is going to sound like the movie is pornography, but I assure you it is not. It's called Dirty Sexy Saint, and it's for a streaming network called Passion Flicks, which adapts steamy romance novels into movies. Another tax credit project called Red Hour, starring John Malkovich and Tyrese Gibson from the Fast and Furious franchise, shot at a farm in Flemington last year. And an Indian feature film called Shiv Shastri Balboa, shot in Clinton over the summer. They'll also be using the state's film tax incentive. We've also have a couple of music videos, one of which you saw in the video. It was the Selena Gomez song, It Ain't Me, shot in Highbridge on the Arch Street Tunnel in 2017. She wasn't there, unfortunately, but that's all right. It's still pretty cool. And one I did not know, but I just discovered while doing research for this, is Pat Benatar's Love is a Battlefield, shot in Clinton in 1983. And then we had 91 TV shows. Celebrity Wife Swap, shot an episode with Passaic's Joe Piscopo in Lebanon and Lambertville in 2013. There's a couple of investigation discovery docudrama shows with colorful names like I'd Kill for You and Mind of a Murderer. They shot in Hunterdon County over the last decade. Another tax credit project, the Apple TV Plus series Dickinson with Haley Steinfeld as an anachronistic Emily Dickinson, shot at the Black River and Western Railroad in 2019. And just recently, The Daily Show filmed a segment of the house in Kingwood a few months ago. Due to most major productions having offices in New York, much of the production activity has been historically centered in the counties immediately surrounding the city. However, I hope you all know, but if not, hopefully this will be exciting to hear. Hunterdon County now has its very own film commission, headed up by Clinton Mayor Janice Kovach, who's also one of our commissioners. If you haven't been to their website yet, I highly recommend it. It's beautifully laid out and has some really gorgeous photos of the county. So that's where we're at now. Let's take a step back in time and show how we got here. I'm sure you all know that Thomas Edison is central to why New Jersey was the Hollywood before Hollywood. But did you also know that he was a part of the reason the film industry fled out west? Let's start at the beginning with the invention of the motion picture camera. So when we talk about the beginning of motion pictures, we have to remember that the first iteration of them was exactly that, pictures in motion. In 1866, Milton Bradley, the same company that would create the board games Battleship and Connect Four, created the zoetrope, a device for flipping through sequential photographs to give the illusion of motion. In 1878, an English photographer named Edward Muybridge took 12 photos of a horse at full gallop to settle a bet with the former governor of California, Leland Stanford, for whom the university is named. The question was, do all 4 feet of a horse leave the ground at the same time during the trot and gallop? Muybridge set up 12 cameras along a track with triggers that would take a picture as the horse passed it, proving that the horse always had 1 foot on the ground. The following year, Mybridge created a projector to show his photos in succession and exhibit it for an audience in San Francisco. Meanwhile, in New Jersey, Thomas Edison and the Scottish inventor W.K.L. Dixon wanted to be the first to make a moving picture camera. So they filed a preliminary claim with the U.S. Patent Office saying that they were going to develop it in the laboratory in West Orange. This was in 1888, and this is probably where the trouble started. In 1891, Edison and Dixon unveiled the kinetograph, which was powered by an electric motor and used 16 millimeter celluloid film created by George Eastman. Edison took full credit for it, although Dixon and his assistants did most of the experimentation. I'm a little critical of Edison, as you might be able to gather. In 1892, they created the kinetoscope, which was the first film projector. It was a peephole viewing device unveiled at the Brooklyn Institute of Arts and Sciences. The first film shown publicly was called Blacksmith Scene, produced at the world's very first film studio, the Black Maria in West Orange. While the original building was demolished, there's a replica at Thomas Edison National Historical Park, a small house covered in black tar paper with a huge glass window on the top to let in enough sunlight to expose the film. It was built on a rotating platform so the studio could follow the sun throughout the day. 2 years later, public screenings began in kinetograph parlors. This is 1894. Most of these early films were very simple vaudeville acts and scenes of everyday life until 1903, when director Edwin S. Porter created The Great Train Robbery, a 12-minute film for the Edison Company. It's one of the first films to use cross-cutting, which is showing simultaneous action taking place in two separate locations to build suspense, and which has become an essential part of film language still used today. The film was shot in South Mountain Reservation and along the Delaware, Lackawanna, and Western Railroad. It was a huge hit due to its Wild West violence. I'm sure you've seen the image of the cowboy looking directly at the camera and firing his gun. If not, I certainly hope you've seen the shot at the end of Goodfellas with Newark native Joe Pesci doing the same thing, which was Scorsese's homage to the Great Train Robbery. In the early 1900s, the industry moved across the Hudson to Manhattan because of the ease of finding booking agents, actors, vaudeville performers, and costume and set designers. But toward the end of the first decade of the 20th century, audiences became bored with painted backdrops and wanted more films made on location. This is a theme that will be repeated throughout film history, leaving the studio for on-location photography to capture more of the audience's everyday experiences. As a result, starting in 1909, Fort Lee became the film capital of the country. The Palisades could stand in for canyons, and the Hudson River could look like a seaside harbor or even the ocean. Fun fact, cliffs of the Palisades are where the term cliffhanger came from. A serial called The Perils of Pauline would often end with the main character literally hanging from a cliff. Later, big Hollywood names like Fatty Arbuckle, Mary Pickford, D.W. Griffith, the Marx Brothers, Max Sennett, Douglas Fairbanks, and Drew Barrymore's great-grandfather, Maurice Barrymore, all either got their start or worked in Fort Lee. Additionally, some pioneering filmmakers worked in Fort Lee. Oscar Michaud, a Black filmmaker, made Within Our Gates in 1919, which was a response to D.W. Griffith's incredibly racist and unfortunately very influential Birth of a Nation. And Alice Guy Blaché opened the Solex Company in Fort Lee in 1910. Actually, I think I need to double check that. That might've been in Bayonne. She was not only one of the, no, it was Fort Lee. Sorry, scratch that. She was not only one of the first women to direct a film, but one of the first businesswomen in the film industry. Many film studios still in existence today got their start in Fort Lee. Fox Film Corporation, opened by William Fox in 1914, is now 20th Century Studios. Goldwyn Pictures Corporation rented studios in Fort Lee and released films made there starting in 1917. It's now MGM. And Universal Film Manufacturing Company built a studio in Fort Lee in 1916 and has now shortened their name mercifully to just Universal Studios or Universal Pictures. 1918, a coal shortage combined with a brutal winter and the Spanish flu pandemic caused many of Fort Lee's studios to close. Rather than reopen, most decided to move to California for their consistent temperatures, perpetually sunny skies, and as I alluded to earlier, to get away from Thomas Edison, who formed a consortium that vigorously, sometimes violently, with the help of the mob, defended his patents on both the production and distribution of films. 3 decades passed before the movies returned to New Jersey, when Elia Kazan directed Marlon Brando in On the Waterfront, filmed in Hoboken in 1954. Right around 1962, the old Hollywood studio system started to collapse as audiences were yet again tired of seeing grandiose big budget epics filmed on a backlot in Los Angeles, like 1963's Cleopatra, which nearly bankrupted 20th Century Fox with a budget equivalent to $200 million in today's dollars. As a result, on-location filming became more in demand once again. Major films from the 60s and 70s shot in Jersey were The Miracle Worker, filmed at the Peapack and Gladstone train station and in Middletown in 1962. Patty Duke, who played Helen Keller, and Anne Bancroft, who played the titular Miracle Worker, won Best Acting Oscars. Alfred Hitchcock shot Marnie, starring Tippi Hedren and Sean Connery, at the Atlantic City Racecourse in Mays Landing, 1964. Midnight Cowboy with Dustin Hoffman and John Voight, the only X-rated movie to win an Oscar for Best Picture, filmed in North Bergen and Jersey City in 1969. Hudson County stood in for Texas. The King of Marvin Gardens with, as I mentioned, Jack Nicholson, one of New Jersey's own, and Bruce Dern, Ellen Burstyn, filmed in Atlantic City and at Lucy the Elephant in Margate in 1972. The Godfather, filmed at Liberty State Park, also in 72. You may have heard the line, "Leave the gun, take the cannoli." That was uttered at what is now Liberty State Park, back when it was kind of just fields and swamps. Brian De Palma's first film, Sisters, with Margot Kidder, shot out in Great Meadows in Independence Township in 1973. Robert Redford and Faye Dunaway did a scene for 3 Days of the Condor in the Hoboken train station. I think that was in 74. I forgot to write the date down for that one. In the late 1970s, New Jersey was going through its worst recession since the Great Depression due to inflated energy prices, coupled with much of our heavy industry leaving for the Sunbelt states or overseas. So in 1978, Governor Brendan Byrne, who prior to Governor Murphy's win last night, was the only Democratic governor to be elected in 2 terms, created the New Jersey Motion Picture and Television Commission to attract the film industry back to the state where it started. He was looking for a way to bring new business to the state that would not add to the state's pollution problems and would improve the state's image. One of the first major motion pictures completed with the commission's assistance was the Amityville Horror, filmed in 1978 in Point Pleasant, Toms River, Lakewood, and Scotch Plains. And since the inception of the film commission, the film industry has brought in billions of dollars of economic activity to the state. Throughout the 80s and 90s, we were booming with production. Friday the 13th, Creepshow, The Muppets Take Manhattan, Desperately Seeking Susan, Presumed Innocent, Malcolm X, all of Kevin Smith's movies, Independence Day, Casino, Ransom, Copland, Devil's Advocate, Godzilla, the Matthew Broderick one, Analyze This and its sequel, Analyze That, Rounders, Being John Malkovich, and of course, The Sopranos, perhaps the most influential TV show in TV history, certainly a watershed moment for what TV could be. I just heard that David Chase said Tony did die at the end of the season finale after the screen cut to black, so I guess that mystery is finally solved. However, in 1997, Canada, our neighbor to the north, introduced the world's first film production incentives. This led to what's called runaway production, as films and TV shows fled up north, and then to an arms race here in the U.S. as states try to compete to bring production back to the USA from our northern neighbor. New Jersey had a tax credit through 2015, although due in part to the state's slow recovery from the Great Recession, the program was frozen in 2010. The press reported that it was halted because Governor Christie didn't care for how the state was portrayed in MTV's Jersey Shore and was appalled by their application for a $420,000 tax credit. I'm here to tell you that is not true. The program was suspended a full year before Governor Christie vetoed Jersey Shore's tax credit, which happened in 2011. But at this point, it's like the famous quote from the man who shot Liberty Valance: when the legend becomes fact, print the legend. In the time since the tax credit program was frozen and then allowed to sunset, we lost a number of projects that were set in New Jersey, but decided to film in other states to take advantage of their programs, including American Hustle, David O. Russell film, Bradley Cooper and Jennifer Lawrence. They inquired about shooting in Atlantic City, but ended up in Massachusetts. The story, which is the Abscam story, in case you forgot, took place in Atlantic City in Camden. And you may recall that the film was nominated for 10 Academy Awards, including Best Picture. John Wick with Keanu Reeves, the action franchise. They looked at Liberty State Park, but ended up in New York. And the film took place in Jersey as well, at least in the beginning where his house was. That film has now spawned an entire franchise with a spinoff in the works. And probably most famously, HBO's Boardwalk Empire, which was going to use a stretch of boardwalk in Asbury Park for the first season, but then moved the entire show to Brooklyn. That show ran for 5 seasons and won 20 Emmys. But since Governor Murphy signed the Garden State Film and Digital Media Jobs Act in 2018, we have seen a significant uptick in film production. In 2017, the total financial impact of the film industry was around $60 million. So this is the year before the film the incentives were signed. The next year, with just three projects that received a tax credit, which was Joker, the NBC show The Enemy Within, and an indie comedy called A Nice Girl Like You, the financial impact nearly doubled. And in 2019, with 22 projects, including HBO's The Plot Against America, Netflix's Army of the Dead, and the recently premiered The Many Saints of Newark, the total went up to, wait for it, $420 million. Just from those tax credit projects, the total number of jobs created is approximately 10,300. Again, that's only from 22 projects out of the 830 total projects that filmed in New Jersey in 2019. Obviously, 2020's numbers will be down, but 2021 has already roared back, as I mentioned before, and we're hoping to clear the half a billion mark in the upcoming years. West Side Story is also premiering. I talked before about the image benefits the state receives. West Side Story is premiering later this year. We certainly hope the film is an Oscar contender. It's Steven Spielberg, so that's a good bet. If so, that would be 3 years in a row where one or more films made in New Jersey were in the Best Picture race. Joker, which filmed in Newark and Jersey City, and The Irishman, which filmed in Paterson, were at the 2020 Best Picture contenders. And this year, The Trial of Chicago 7, which filmed all over North Jersey, was also in the Best Picture category. Fortunately, none of them have taken home the gold yet, but you know, we're hopeful. In terms of upcoming products that I can talk about, probably one that we're most excited for is called The Greatest Beer Run Ever, which will star Zac Efron, Russell Crowe, and Bill Murray. It's the story of a man leaving New York in 1967 to bring beer to his childhood buddies in the army while they're fighting in Vietnam. And it's Peter Farrelly's first movie after his Oscar wins for Green Book. They'll be shooting in Hudson County this month. I, of course, will always remember Peter Farrelly for his decidedly more lowbrow fare like Dumb and Dumber and There's Something About Mary. So I'm pretty excited about this one. Additionally, New Jersey's first purpose-built studio opened in Jersey City this month. It's called Sinnelee Studios Caven Point. It's three enormous cavernous sound stages, column-free, each 50 feet tall. We already have quite a bit of interest in them, but I'm not authorized to talk about what exactly the projects are, but you'll be seeing stuff in the news. Other studios opening in New Jersey are Palisade Stages in Kearney and Super Studios in Harrison. And we have others in development all over the state, including as far down as Deerfield Township in Cumberland County. And before you ask, I don't have any inside scoop on Netflix bid on Fort Monmouth, other than to say that we're all very excited at the possibility of them converting the fort into an enormous studio complex. So what I hope you take away from this is that when people talk about the film industry or Canada or Great Britain or Yollywood, as they call it down in Georgia, and especially if you ever hear someone saying New Jersey is Hollywood on the Hudson, just remember that we had the film industry first. And no matter how many times it strays from New Jersey, we always bring it back. I try to work a Godfather 3 quote into there with the, every time I get out, they bring me back in, but I never was able to quite figure it out. So anyway, that's my thing. So I'll open it up to some questions.
Everyone, you can unmute yourself and ask questions. Anybody have questions for Joe? So I just hearing the list of films, most of the probably Northern New Jersey, but I'm really intrigued with the amount of film and TV industry, the films that have been made in Clinton. That's amazing. I mean, that's, less than 20 miles from us, like less than 15 miles from us. So, What is the attraction? Well, there's a lot to attract you to Clinton, but besides the little town itself, I mean, is that where these were filmed, or is it like the countryside?
I think it's probably mostly people will go to the town itself. It's very kind of storybook there. We do have some interest in the houses and stuff around there. One of the things I would say for I know that the Hunterdon County Film Commission is working on this as well, is, and what we've been talking about with other towns and counties throughout the state, is that we have on our website an ability to upload your own location. So if you wanted to upload your house or if you owned a business or something, you could submit photos and it would go right to our website and we would be able to promote it there. We know about what's going on in terms of, you have anything very like specific to your project property, you know, like whatever, like a stream or a forest or a pool even. We get all sorts of crazy requests for things. So the more we know about what people have, the easier it is to, you know, get filmmakers to look beyond those couple North Jersey counties. You know, as I mentioned, we represent the entire state. So we definitely want to make sure that everyone gets a piece of the pie.
So do you mainly, do you contact officials in each town to get permission? Is that where you start, or is it with the individual who may have submitted their barn or their house, so, or is it a combination?
If it's private property, we would have the filmmakers would obviously have to get permission from the private property owner first to make sure that, you know, they're allowed to film. And then from there, we usually ask them as well to let the town know. You know, you may have like nosy neighbors or what, depending on where the neighborhood is. And if they see a bunch of production trucks and people milling around and unusual activity, they may call the police. And the last thing when you are filming and it's, you know, they could be as much as a 12-hour day, the last thing you want is the cops to show up, shut everything down. And then somebody has to go out and explain to them that you have permission to be on this property. So that's a big part of what we do, is to make sure that everyone's on the same page, everyone's aware of what's going on, especially now with these major productions. You know, West Side Story could have as many as something like that. It was like 100 extras on set. So, you know, that's a big, I mean, obviously that was, they closed down like streets in Patterson and stuff for that. But other productions, you know, it's a lot of people, and it may be a little bit alarming to people that aren't aware, neighbors and the like that aren't aware what's going on. So our big thing is to make sure the towns are aware and they know, and certain towns as well have private property permit fees, which I'm not a huge fan of personally, but I certainly understand it for public property. The town should absolutely be charging a fee for that. But, you know, we do want to make sure that the production companies follow all the local laws and the ordinances. So if there is a private property fee, then they would have to, of course, get a proper permissions to film on that property. I don't think that's an issue out in Huntington County from the couple towns that have film permits out there.
So you have a log of different properties and scenes that people have submitted to you. And then if someone has an idea for a film and you're looking for a special barn or our windmill, for example,
right,
then you have that. So that's something that someone could submit as a possibility.
Okay. Exactly. Yeah, they could submit it. It would live on our website, be publicly available. And the nice thing about our website as well, the software that we use, it also it brings everything over onto this international location scouting database called Locations Hub. So you could be in Dubai or in Thailand and you're looking to film in a barn or at a windmill, and you know, something in Holland could show up, Holland Township could show up there. And then you would, you know, they would contact us and we'd be like, oh yeah, sure, here's the information for filming on that property. And, you know, hopefully it's that way to extend our reach to places that may not have even thought about filming in New Jersey. Now all of a sudden they're like, oh wow, this is an option for me.
How does New Jersey compare to other states? I mean, of course, I'm sure New York is probably number one. New York and California, are they number one as far as filming?
You know, actually, Georgia is huge.
Georgia.
Yeah, Georgia's huge. They have all the Marvel films shoot down there and the TV shows. I was just speaking to my boss earlier. I'm not sure if you know that the Disney Plus has all the Marvel live action TV shows now. And one of the upcoming ones is Miss Marvel, who is, she's a Muslim American teenage girl that lives in Jersey City in the comic books. And they filmed almost the entire show down in Georgia. And I am very upset with them.
Yes.
I'm still going to watch it begrudgingly, but
yes.
Yeah, I want to bring her home if that's possible.
Absolutely. Wow.
Mm-hmm. So Georgia's huge. New York obviously has a lot going on, but one of the big advantages to Jersey over New York is that it's a lot of crew base that work in New York or had worked in New York prior to the tax incentive. They live in Jersey, so they don't now need to cross, you know, two rivers and go out all the way out to the tip of Long Island to film. And they were missing graduations and weddings and birthdays, sure, and all kinds of stuff. And now they're working within, you know, an hour or so of their house, which is great. We've been hearing from a lot of union members and crew members that just been saying it's been a really fantastic experience to work in their home state. And obviously parking is a lot easier here depending on where you go, as long as you're not in like Jersey City or Hoboken.
Other questions? I don't want to hog the time. Allison, Joanne, any questions? Very interesting.
Well, thank you. Yeah, it's a lot of fun doing the research for this stuff to see. But I knew turbulence had shot in Jersey, but I never really looked that heavily into where exactly it had shot. And there's a whole article about how all the merchants in Clinton were very upset because they didn't. It was right around Valentine's Day, and they lost all this foot traffic. And
Clinton's a beautiful little walking town.
Yeah,
got the Red Mill there, the museum. Yeah. Any other questions? Anything? I don't want to keep Joe too long. Okay, well, thank you, Joe. I really appreciate everything you told us tonight. It's mind-boggling. And I'm glad we recorded it. If you signed in late, you can go to the library website. Within the next couple of weeks, our librarian will edit and then put the recording up on YouTube, our Holland Township Library YouTube channel, so you can watch all of it again, anything you missed. So if you signed in late, I know Joe showed a little a movie of, you know, some of the productions here and how and where they were made. So very interesting. So thank you, Joe, for all the time you took to be with us tonight. We really do appreciate it.
Thank you again for having me. It was a lot of fun.
Thanks. And thanks everybody for coming tonight.
Yes, thank you all. Thanks all for tuning in. All right. Well, everyone have a great night.
All right. Take care.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye.